time out of your busy schedule to come over and listen to us, and hopefully you'll leave here a little bit more informed and a little bit more at ease as to what's going on. First and foremost, let me clarify, that is not Paul Innes.
No.
This is Marius. Marius is here to help us. We're hoping that we can get the UAT site hooked up where we can actually show you some demos of the CBP site itself. But just by way of history, some of you may know, some of you may not know, going back in 2002, General Registry embarked on a new vision, and that vision was to convert the registry into a full electronic register for all of the registers. And we have progressively gone through that. We started, first of all, with services to CSPs like Chorus, EDMS, now we have CAP. But it was always the intention of having a portal for the businessman as well, who manage their own companies from their office or from at home in some instances. CBP is the answer to that. We did a soft rollout of it in October 2017. And as we progress, we've now added some more bits and bobs to it. And as we go along, you'll find that more services will come online via CBP to you as an individual with a registered company. It doesn't apply to sole traders. It is in the plans that you will be able to go in here at some point in the not too distant future and also renew your trade and business license and do some other work with government without having to leave the portal. But that's all in the works. We at Registry was just a little bit fast off of the stocks, so some of the other departments are still trying to catch up. but we're not waiting on them. They have to actually catch up, because if we slow down, then we start pulling back on services that our customers like yourselves would need. Right now, CBP offers some services. Those services are, first and foremost, your annual returns, if you haven't filed them as yet, but you're into the penalty phase now. But the good thing is that you can actually sign up on CBP, file your annual return, and pay your annual fee at the same time. You can also, if you need a good standing for your bank or you're doing business elsewhere, good standing and other certificates are also now available via CBP. Again, it's using, at the moment, a debit card or a credit card. Now, another feature that will be available to for persons who's on CBP in another few weeks is that the fact we recognize there are some entities that have more than one entity. I don't want to call any names, but we have one company and they have some subsidiaries to that, and the organizations are functioning as companies, and to use a debit or credit card really doesn't fall into the real mainframe of how they do business. So we recognize that. So what we are going to actually do is that you'll have another feature available where that you can deposit a check to an escrow account, just like the CSPs do right now. And from that account, whatever services that you request, it will automatically deduct the fee. You will get your receipt, you will get your document. Sorry. In terms of passing documents, for instance, the certificates, if you order a certificate, you don't have to come in and pick it up. We send it to you via email. It goes into your Dropbox on CBP, and we're hoping that we can get to the UAT site a bit later on, and we can show you that. So any documents that you get from us will actually be lodged in that. You can then log into your portal, pull down the document that you need, print it off, or you can forward it by email to someone else. The beauty is we've actually given you a filing system as well, because whatever documents you get from us will always be into that documents received box, and they'll be there for time immemorial unless you delete it. So if you got a certificate or if you get certified copies of your memo and arts, they will always be there, like I say, unless you decide that you want to delete it. So we've given you some some tools to work with. The next phase of that major phase is the registration of local companies. So if there's anyone here today that have a company or you want to form a new company, normally right now you come in to register with a handful of paper, a check or cash, and some stamps from the post office and say, I want to register this company. With the portal, you don't do that. You hop on, You do, even if you don't have a company right now, you can still sign up without having to own a company. You hop on CBP, you input all the information that you need, it will prompt you as to what documents you have to upload, and you submit it, and again, either it's by escrow account or you can put your credit card info in. It will then be processed, and stamp copies of the documents will then come back to your inbox. You'll get an email saying that it's been approved or rejected or whatever the case may be. It's now in your inbox, and you can pick it up from there. So all of that will save you the hassle of coming down to the registry and coming back. if you want to do amendments to those, in the next 6 months, you'll also be able to do that. Some people amend the memoirs from time to time. All of the services that you conduct with the registry at the counter now will be available to you as a customer via CVP, just like you would walk into the counter. It's not that we don't want to see you guys anymore, it's just we want to make life easier for you. So that's all in the works. What's live and on there right now for registration, if anyone is connected with NPOs, you can actually sign up on CVP and register your NPO on CVP. Again, you don't have to come into the registry to bring any of those documents. You can do it all on here. beneficial shareholder information. I'm not going to go into the beneficial ownership stuff, but you know that's coming. I'm going to leave that for Mr. Ennis to go into details on that and how and why and when you must file it. But that's also available on here right now. So you can hop on here, upload the necessary documentation for yourself, and file it. Two things is good for you as a consumer with CVP right now. One, the access and the service online using CVP will always be free to you. There's absolutely no cost to you to sign up and to use it to manage your company. The only fees that you will be paying is in the statutory fees of documents that you request, or if you do a registration. The filing of beneficial ownership information right now is free. The filing of annual return, as you know, has always been free, it's still free. So there's no cost associated whatsoever with access or with the amount of users that you have. One of the questions we've got recently, there's a number of persons who own a company or companies, and they get another office, a registered office, someone else to do their filings for them with the registry. They're busy or they're just, whatever the reason is. And we've had people that come in and do that work for other people, want to sign up and get access to the company. Unfortunately, we can't do that. You as the owner have to go on and apply for access to your company. And we ask you for certain information that we can go to our files and verify that, yes, that's Mr. White, and he owns X, and we will then go through to make sure the signature matches all the rest of it, and then boom, we can get an email saying your access to this company has been approved, you now have full access to your company online. If you as an individual owner want to now share those credentials that you set up and with someone else to manage that, that's entirely your responsibility, it's entirely your risk. We won't get into that. So, like I said, we've had to turn several people away. We've seen them come in online where they're asking for X, Y, and Z because they are companies that they manage for people, but we can't do that. You as an individual donor has to do it. some people are upset with us for that, but unfortunately, we look at it as a way of making the life of the businessman in Cayman easier by giving them this portal. to use it, it's really simple. It walks you right through the entire process. You don't have to go searching what you should do next or next one. Yes, sir.
Information that's already on file that you have, that we have put into the register, is that in there already, or we got to go and duplicate that?
Everything that we have on file is there. What we're doing, that's exactly what I said. The information that we have on file, when you submit an application for access to a company.
No, but say we've done this years ago before CBP started. All that is?
You will have access to all your entire company file. You will have access to your entire company file, and anything that you want a copy of, you'll be able to request it on here. So you may have, may want a copy of a resolution that you filed back in 2001, right? Once you get access to the company, and we have those documents uploaded, because that's another in-house process that's happening right now. As we are doing this, we are actually uploading all of the documents to those companies so it'll be available for you online. And you want a copy of that resolution, you go on, you request it, and it's put in your Dropbox, and then you charge the fee. So everything that you've done before, you will be able to see.
What about companies that haven't got your email?
That's why we're here.
No, the companies that haven't got your email, basically, that say, I know of another company that hasn't received the email, and they do their own.
And that's why we're here. We're on the radio. We're putting stuff out in the paper. We decided to address this membership because we know that hopefully we will make people abreast or aware of what's happening now. And then in turn, please pass the word. Right? Because we recognize that if you look at the old annual returns, when they started, email probably wasn't even thought of. It's only in recent years we started adding an email address to it. And even now some people don't even fill it in. So we've gone through, and what we've done, we've taken our entire register, picked out all of the local companies that doesn't use a CSP, and we're trying to reach out to them. So we're trying to reach everybody in all of the media through radio, through events like this, and through general word of mouth. We also recognize that you're working, you're running a business. So what we have done from now through June, we at Register have extended our operational hours. So on Tuesdays and Thursdays, we're open, we continue on, we don't close at 5, we open until 7:30. So 7:30 p.m., that will give you the chance to come in after your office hours are closed at 5, if you have such hours, and actually sign up. We have people there like Floss and some other assistant registrar, some other support staff that can help you sign up and walk you through the process. I see a few people that's been in already, hopefully they can vote. It's not that difficult to do. It's just a matter of getting the information in and getting it back. And what we do, we try to fast track. So if you come in after 5 o'clock in the afternoon and you want to sign up, we help people on staff to do instant verification. So you put your information up, and while your information is coming up, they're pulling the file. So by the time it comes in, they can verify, yes, that's Mr. White, approved. And you can stay right there. We'll help you, assist you with the filing of your beneficial ownership information. If you haven't done your annual return, we'll also assist you with that. Once complete, if you want to order a certificate of any sort, we'll help you with that as well. But it's all intuitive. It walks you right through the whole process. And we made it as simple and as easy as possible for everyone to use.
Does it matter which search engine you use?
No, but I found that with Google, it tends to go a bit faster. But it's compatible with IE, all of those. So.
Okay, because I know on some of the government sites,
yes,
they tell you to use Internet Explorer. So.
Yeah, and then you find that the new ones will tell you to use Chrome because they're
right.
Moving the mainframe from one thing to the next, and there's a lot of stuff going on.
When you set up a new user, say the manager is set up on this and he wants to add additional users, are you saying that the person uses their credentials?
Yes, it's only one user.
Okay.
It's only one user. And we have, what we've done, we have to keep it simple and manageable, right? So if you get a big consortium of companies, right, then it'll be up to management of that company to control who has that access to the entity, right?
But one user can have multiple companies, is that correct?
Yes, yes.
Thank you.
Yes, you don't have, if you have more than one company, you don't need to go on and set up an account for each company. You just, as you sign up, you select the companies that you want access to, and when it's approved, you'll have access to all of those. You then have a service corner up in the back that you can select which service, what you want to do, whether it's file beneficial ownership, file annual return, request a certificate, it's all there.
And Donald, for the nonprofit side there, does that automatically be reported to Wilbur's team then?
Yeah, Wilbur actually works with us.
Okay.
We're the housing for NPOs.
Okay.
So the ministry is assisting us in getting the word out and briefing people on what's required. So all this information comes in. The other thing you'll find out on here, we just started yesterday updating the site. So for NPOs, you'll have live updates as NPOs are registered. That list is, will be updated in real time. We, and I'll speak here before it's announced, but the registry itself is launching a brand new website in about a week. And it has a whole new look, a whole new feel. And again, you'll see all of the stuff on there. It'll take you from one to the other. And when you get there, again with NPOs, there's a list which you can either search or you can scroll through if you want to go, but it's updated in real time. Right? So if you've got an NPO and it's not on that list, then you need to make some inquiries.
If your service provider and you access registered office for local companies, the service provider with a registered office, they should be the ones doing this, right?
The person that owns the entity, owns the company, has to sign up. If they want to then give those credentials to the service provider to manage the company for them, that's entirely up to them. But the service provider themselves cannot log on and select a bunch of companies to get access to them.
So each owner has to, even though the service provider doesn't.
Yes.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because we're doing that confidentiality and we want to make sure that we don't give access to someone, to your company, to somebody else. So that's why we're very meticulous and very strict with it. You know, the individual, we have to have, if you upload a photo ID and we can't see the facial features real clear, you'll find you'll get a rejection. We want to positively identify what we have in the signature. If we can't match the signature to what we have in the file, you may get a rejection. You may get an email asking you to come in, because we want to make sure that, because once we release that to you,
so,
you now have access to that company.
So why do you need photo ID? When we filed for beneficial owners, for exempt companies, so we didn't need to update photo IDs and signatures of the beneficial owners.
Part of the requirement is that we require a photo, an official photo ID, be it passport, driver's license, or voter's registration. We want to satisfy ourselves that Mr. Jones is Mr. Jones. And I wouldn't want to go any further than that, but we just need to be, the registrar needs to satisfy himself that the person that's applying for that access is who they say they are.
This is, CVP is just for ordinary resident companies.
Correct.
It's not for exempted companies.
Right.
Is it? And will we be able to access information on resident companies through CAP, or will it only be?
Only if the resident company is with a CSP.
Mm-hmm.
If it's not, if it's on CVP, no.
Okay, so.
No, it's completely separate.
Yes.
Just going to your office downtown, I can do my trade business license at the same time. You're allowing that through here too?
That's coming.
It's coming?
That's coming.
Okay.
Yeah. That should have been on here in January, but unfortunately there's a different developer involved in that. That's what I'm saying. We were first off the stocks. Then I'll have to catch up. So it'll be on here. You'll also find it on here right now. For those of you who may be in construction, see Ms. Patterson here. There's a link to planning. So you don't need to log into the planning site to get to it. You can go, once you're on here, you can go through it straight from here. Right? And the site will walk you through. It's on the main site, it's also on, once you sign up, it's on there. So that's the first connect we made, then we have TBL, and there's a few other ones that's coming, but they're slow in getting there.
So just to confirm, the only people that can sign up to sign up are shareholders.
Shareholders,
they can they got to pass it on to somebody else, but they're the only ones that can sign up.
The shareholders are directors. We will also do a director of the directors current.
What about officers? If you're an officer of a company, can you sign up?
Yes. Yeah.
So
director, officer, shareholder.
Officers, directors,
shareholder. Yeah. Because
okay.
We recognize that there are some shareholders that when you look at the file, the officers are the ones that's doing all of it.
Right. That's
but only one account can access your company.
Yes.
You can't have three, like a director and a shareholder.
No, it's only
an
one
officer.
Account.
Only one can link to
yes.
that company.
Yeah.
So choose wisely.
Yes. Wise words. Any other questions before we move on?
So when you sign up, you get like a username and a password. Is that what it
yes.
is?
Yes. Username, password, and you obviously need an email address. And what we suggest people do is use a username that and that's easy to remember. I think we got some of the first folks that came in, and I don't think any of them are here today, but it's just a little bit funny. when we were doing the annual return drive and we're trying to get people aware that they came in, there's some people that came in and we said, well, we need to sign you up. And we had one in the office today. They used a username, but they must have just thought it was something that was going to go away. So when they realized that they couldn't remember what name they used, and so they used just gibberish, really, to sign up as a username. There's no way they would remember it. So they had to go through the process all over again because, you know, make sure that you understand that what you're doing is live, it's real, it's not going away, it's just going to be more going to be built on it as we move on.
So yeah. When you get into that situation and you've locked your account,
I will get you sorted when I get back.
Thank you.
Yeah, we've just established, and please, we apologize for the delay.
No problem. I just need to know where we go.
We started this mass campaign of making people aware, and all of a sudden it just boom, it took off, and we've now established a fully fledged and manned all the time CBP help. So you can email help@cbp.ky and someone will either call you or they will email you right back. Unfortunately, my friend here has been waiting for a bit to get there because it's just so many things, but I'll make sure it's done for you tonight. And we can, once you give us the email address or the entity name, we can give you the information on your username if you forgot it. We can also reset your password. There is an automatic password reset. Oh, nice to see you. There is an automatic password reset. And we're doing some tweaks to that right now. So it's not fully operational, but it will be in a very short time.
That's also if you don't forget the gibberish you put in for your password.
Yes.
Questions.
Yeah, because
you
would need that.
I have a question. Let's say that whoever manages the company to incorporate companies and somebody else has managed to input the shareholder information. Does it only have one password and it's only one access you will have? Or
just the one access. Mm-hmm. Just the one access.
Mm-hmm.
So it's entirely up to you to manage that access, right? So you as the owner or the managing director of the company that has set that up, has to make sure that you manage and control who have access to the companies, because again, remember when we actually put it where you have an escrow account, you could have money in that escrow account, and you got a wayward employee giving us money at government for something that's not needed, you know, it's so you really have to, as Will said, choose wisely on who will have access to it.
So if I sign up as the officer of a group of companies, what information do you want from me to sign up?
Photo ID, well, any of the official
passport, driver's license,
voter's ID, and then for the group of companies that you've selected, we will then pull those files what we have on that registry and verify that you have access or you have authority to do business.
So you'll check the ID to what you put into whatever you have
right.
on file right now.
And we check the signature.
Okay.
And then we'll come back, say yea or nay, and there you go.
All right. So it's not too difficult to sign up then?
No, it's not.
We'll go through the process and
yeah.
sure.
Any other questions? I think I can take a break here just to make sure, because we're doing some upgrades to the UAT site, which is what we're on here, and the guys were just back there sweating and trying to get it up. It's up. But I can let it settle a bit and just let Mr. Paul touch on the beneficial ownership information. And then once that's done, then we can go back and we can just do a mock and run through this quickly, and we can take some more questions after that.
So yes. You're a corporate service provider, you have your people register all their individual companies, then you said talk about escrow company, you need to then have individual escrow accounts?
They are individual escrow accounts.
Okay.
Right now it's the same principle. If any of you use our search engine on our general website, I think most of you probably Chorus or EDMS, yeah. But on our general website, we have a search feature. So anyone, wherever they are in this universe, can log into that website, set up an account using a credit card, and they can do company searches. And the different searches that they go, they have a choice. They can either do a one-time search, or they can top up an escrow account using the credit card, and it automatically draws them.
Well, that was more of the for ordinary resident companies. Your corporate service providers, what they're going to register, and then they're going to give you the information because they're too busy to do it. Now, as a corporate service provider, I'm doing it for everyone. I have all the passwords and all that stuff. Do I need then now set up individual escrow accounts for each one of these ordinary?
No, you don't. That's automatically done. Once they sign up, it's done.
Yeah, but once, I then have to have it and put a check into each one of these things.
Well, you would have to put, if they want to use the check set, you would have, yes, it. But it's not, you don't have to, not like Chorus, we have to play and we set you up.
Okay.
Because if we have certain parameters or certain rules that has to be met,
yes,
in order to get a Chorus and Cap, right? This is automatic. You go on, you sign up, the account is already there.
So it'll be their information.
It'll be their information.
Or whatever.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Ms. Dennis, I will let you have a few minutes to explain the beneficial ownership. This is Mr. Paul Innes, who is the head of compliance at General Registry. And he will give you some details on the beneficial ownership and where we're at and where we're going and what you need to do.
Thank you. Good evening. Please go to Andy Messenger. Messenger. Not the catalyst of disinformation, the messenger. So please don't shoot the messenger. So the issue of beneficial ownership is something that is an international requirement.
Someone shooting already?
Yeah. It is an international requirement by consequence of the fact that we're the fifth largest international financial sector. There are international requirements that we have to comply with, unfortunately or fortunately, depending on the opinion you have. Between 2015 and 2016, the EU, at that point in time, Britain was a part of the EU, and the EU passed some special resolutions that said all of the entities associated with the EU were required to create a public register. Obviously, that was not the intention of the government. The government then saw an alternative, and the alternative was for us to create our own registry, which is not public, but it is a registry that has to be created, which then provides access to law enforcement only. So that is what we have created. There are two elements to the current BO regime. There are the exempt companies. For those people involved in the exempt companies, you have heard of the requirements to file beneficial ownership information, which is a monthly filing. And then we have the ordinary process that was set up by CBP, which is a one-time-a-year filing. So for the ordinary companies, the process is a lot easier than for the exempt companies. So just let me say that for all those local company owners in the room, just a piece. So that's the first thing. So what is beneficial ownership? The law says that if you are a 25% shareholder, if you have 25% voters' rights, or if you have the ability to appoint or remove a director, if you're the ultimate shot caller who sits behind the scenes and gives instructions, or there's this other fifth element, something called the joint arrangement. That is for those individuals who fall below the 25% threshold. So if 10 of us in this room decide that we are going to form a company, we have decided where we are all the owners of this company, it is a joint arrangement. But we decided that Donald Dixon, he will be the point of contact with General Registry to provide General Registry with forming that company, subscribing, etc. But we are all still beneficial owners. So all the information on us has to be submitted. As I said earlier, it's a one-time information. So what is the information we require?
I mean, all 10 people have to get photo ID or?
Yes, and there's a reason for that.
If only one person is having access to anybody, any or 10 people.
Because we need to know who the beneficial owners are. And I'll tell you why. There is a saying in the Caribbean. All of us are familiar with this word. You ever hear the word thiefing? It's a Bajan word. Because of thiefing is the reason why we are where we are now. I work at the Financial Crime Unit. And I've seen the abuse of ordinary companies in these islands. I've seen the abuse of ordinary companies worldwide. So to make it very simple, it's because of that. That's the reason why. The law says that if you don't go with a corporate service provider, but you choose to allow General Registry to perform the role of corporate service for you, then that's the reason why we need it. Because we don't have to perform the role of KYC. If you go with a corporate service provider, you would have to give them all that information. A agree? For anybody who's done a corporate service before.
Yeah.
So the same information you would have to give to your corporate service provider, you don't have to give to the general registry, because we are performing that role for you. You don't have to pay us, it is free. But if you go with one of the other corporate service providers, there's a rumor over there, and this is just a rumor, that some of them may be charging between $1,000 and $1,500 to do this, what we're doing for free. So you think about that. You're required, yes ma'am?
On ordinary companies, we file annually the annual return.
On the annual return,
it has who the members are.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So you're going one stage further now and asking those owners to verify that they truly are the owners and put up their photo IDs.
Exactly.
But can I just interject there? Sure. You'll also have ordinary companies where shareholders are not listed. So, and they are quite common, believe it or not. Our beneficial owners are not listed as a shareholder, but in the scenario that Paul just gave, they can call the shots. They can fire someone. They can change the whole workings of the company. They sit behind the scenes, and that's my company.
Of course.
And I want you to do this, and I want you to do that.
Yep.
So the annual return will remain as is. You will file that just as it is. The beneficial ownership now is a different document asking for more information that will bring those people to the fore.
Much like a corporate service, I work for a corporate service provider. So I took what they needed to provide to the portal, took all that data, and created my beneficial ownership register for my local company.
Good.
I took the ID numbers and the dates of issue and all of that, but I did not take a copy of the ID of the other owners of my company. Are you saying I need to go back to them?
No, I'm not saying that.
Oh, good. Okay, thank you.
But for us,
okay,
we need that, because on the corporate service side,
to do this, I would have to upload their passport or just the details of their information?
Just the details.
Okay.
You don't need to upload anything. You just need to provide the details.
Okay.
It says upload a copy of the ID, because I've done mine.
Yeah.
You have to upload an ID.
For all of them.
Because after you upload the ID, you have to put in the correct information that is on the ID.
Yeah.
So there's a verification process.
All right, so I have to go get that again.
Yes. No, I thought you were talking about from the CSP side.
From the CSP side, I know that we provide the text file and all of that, and we hold the due diligence on those clients because we're the service provider.
Exactly.
But on my local company,
you have to provide it.
I have that information because I created a beneficial ownership register for my local company, but what it's sounding like is I have to go back to them and say, could I have your passport again so I can upload a copy of that when I do load it, when I have access.
And the reason for that is, we have to perform the KYC.
Okay.
We will scrub these names.
Sure.
We have to do the work that would have been done now by the corporate service provider. We are the ones who will be doing it in our general registry. So that's the reason why you have to upload the certified IDs.
And at the one time a year, if there's no change to those people and there's no expiration of that document, will I have to upload that document again?
It's just a notification. And that's actually going in as a hot fix to it and leaking.
Okay.
Where that would be there. There's no changes, but you still have to file, even though just like the CSP.
And as long as I track their expiration dates on their passports, I won't have to upload anything when there's no change in ownership. Okay. Thank you.
I have a question. If you're a CSP and you have a book of ordinary residents in your book, up until now we've been using the portal.
Yes.
Which is a monthly frequency.
Yes.
We know now that we don't need to file them monthly based on the fact that they're ordinary and they can be filed every 12 months.
Yes.
Do we continue to file via the portal? Do you expect us to pull them out of the monthly reports and only submit them every 12 months? Does it matter if we report them monthly?
Well, this is what I'll say. I'll answer what the law says.
Mm-hmm.
The law says you're only supposed to provide local companies once a year. And the law says that you're supposed to provide exempt companies once a month.
So separate report upload for the ordinaries, remove them from the other filings every month.
Well, if you've provided them already, then it will be in the best over your 10 companies going forward monthly. That would be easier for them to do. So for the ordinary companies, again, just like the exempt companies, there are, you need to be aware of the issues if you don't provide the information. The law says that if you don't provide the information, we, the registrar, since we're performing the role of CSP, we would issue to you what is, in the law says, a restriction notice. And that restriction notice then speaks to how your account at the registry of the Dublin in terms of your shares. You should also be aware that if we issue that restriction notice, the bank may ask for a copy of that restriction notice. So that may then affect your ability to have access to your money. So again, these are the things that you need to be aware of. We don't anticipate having to issue a restriction notice to ordinary companies because it is a very simple process. We are here to inhibit business. We are here to assist businesses in growing. But at the same time,
that's where the messenger gets shot.
At the same time, let us just remember that the more compliant we are as a jurisdiction, the better for business it is. Because then we avoid blacklisting, we avoid all these different international reputational issues. Are there any questions or anything that I've said so far? So just remember, what a beneficial one is, 25%. So if you fall below the 25% threshold with the voter's rights or ID or shares, then you go to number three. Is it an individual who can remove or appoint a voter director? If you're not getting that, then you go to number four. Mm-hmm. Is this individual the ultimate shortfall? And if you don't have that, then you have to join the arrangements, so then you provide the information. But in one of those five scenarios, there must be beneficial ownership information. And you provide that to us once a year. Just once a year. And as Mr. Donald said, we're doing after hours work. And I'm not getting any overtime just for this to everybody. But I have to be here. And I volunteer to it because I understand the process. Like everything new, people need some assurance, people need some guidance, people need some assistance. That is why we are here for it. It's not a very difficult process, ladies and gentlemen.
So now it's the end of June, but next year, what would be the deadline for the filing? Would it be the 31st of March, like your annual term? Or is it remaining June?
Good question.
And that's a good question because the law only was written for the start, but it's once a year. So again, I do believe what would be a best practice. We can issue some directive to the industry to ask individuals to provide it at least by the end of March, just like what you would provide your annual returns. Should you just get it all the way at one time? And and the other thing to note is that
anniversary of your setting up of the company, or is it automatically January to December?
Calendar.
Yes. But if you set the company up in July, back to June?
If you set the company up in
July, calendar.
It's the calendar.
Calendar.
If you set the company up in July, still January.
For half a year then?
No. Still for the
year.
For
the
year
from July to June.
January. Yeah, the double rate fees.
It starts in January. The other thing to know before I leave is that if you make any changes to your beneficial owners, you have 30 days to tell us, 30 days to inform us. So it means that you have to, the same information you would have provided at the inception on the beneficial owners, if there are any changes to the beneficial owners, we need that information within 30 days. If you don't do it within 30 days, then, and we don't anticipate people not doing it again within 30 days, the local companies, most of them are very compliant, very obedient, and very law-abiding. There are just a few who are involved with thieving, but nobody in this room. Nobody in this room, for sure. And when I say thieving, it simply means that I've seen companies set up, ladies and gentlemen, for the sole purpose of laundering. The business now, just set up, get a bank account, and lots of money that was stolen, put into it, and people were able to benefit.
Just one question. You talked about beneficial ownership, so you called certain people shock callers?
A shock caller. One person falls in that category.
How do you define what is that? I mean, that's pretty great, isn't it?
Not necessarily. If you set up a company for an individual, if I want to be a shock caller,
Yeah.
And I say to Mr. Donnie, I say to Marius, and I say to Frost, I want you, the purpose of documentation, to be the shareholders and the directors. My name don't need to be on anything. But there's an agreement that we signed between us that says I'm the one who's in charge of this.
So it has to be a written
money.
Agreement then?
It must be. It's, it, well, mm-hmm. There must be something written somewhere. Otherwise, they can claim it as my company, not yours. So there must be some document written, some agreement that says the ultimate shop caller.
And that happens.
Or otherwise known as fronting, right?
Yeah, that's what I thought.
I mean, we've seen this. This happens all the time.
So if somebody is fronting for somebody but there's no written agreement, then they're not a shop caller, officially.
Officially.
Legally speaking.
That would not stand in court.
The
agreement that you signed between those three persons don't allow you anything worse if you don't meet the requirements to be a part of it.
Who says that?
Everybody loses.
Worse if you're an expat, you're
all losing.
And what if you're not an expat?
Well, then you have to prison.
All these narrows in the law, ladies and gentlemen, I've seen already within the realm of finance and investigation. And not only locally, but it has been seen internationally. I mean, you look at all the typologies of abuse, the typologies of corruption, the typologies of money laundering, involving legal persons and arrangements. All five of these categories are the common thresholds that we get all the time. These commonalities, those five categories, at the end of the day, are the beneficial ones, the individuals who have the ability to make decisions on legal persons. Quickly, if it is that you have a shareholder who is a company, like for example, if you have a parent company, and within, under the parent company, there's a subsidiary, and the parent company either owns the majority shares or more than 25%, then you are, for filing for beneficial ownership, you just need to provide the name of the company and the incorporation number. So what you're just required to upload would be your certificate of incorporation. Because the individuals who own that subsidiary are also the individuals who own the parent company. So you don't need to repeat that information.
Question.
Yes, ma'am.
If I'm coming to you to help me set this up with
yes,
owning more than one company, say three or four companies,
right.
What document do I need to know?
All the documents that you have to show who are the five or four categories. So you should be able to walk with obviously memos and articles and a certificate of incorporation that says the company, registered shareholders and directors, and all of the relevant IDs and requirements.
Yeah, no, if you would. You say you're coming to a file?
Well, there are a few companies that I'm involved with, and of course, assume all the
Yeah, but well, all you need to walk with when you come is identification for whoever the shareholders in that company.
That's it,
because we have the other stuff on file.
Okay,
right? If you're doing it from your office, then again, there's the ID. If one of the shareholders is a company, then you, of course, you need the certificate of incorporation to upload, right? You need that. And while I managed to get in here. One thing I omitted to mention as well, to show how serious we are about helping you folks get online and get this sorted out, we will actually make appointments and come to your office. If you're a business and you find it difficult to come to us, we have a team that will actually come out to your office and assist you in signing up, right? So we've got the after hours, we got the appointment schedule, we will do all of that. Just if we want to make sure and give everybody the opportunity to really get signed up and get this stuff in, that they don't run into any issues later on.
Very perfect. We're confident that everybody will meet the deadline.
So Ms. Pat, we can come to your office if you like.
But you can come anytime. You can come anytime during the day.
Yeah, you can come anytime during the day up until 7:30 in the night on Tuesdays and Thursdays. Or if not, like I say, we can visit
yes,
yours.
Sir.
Touching on something you said, you have a company,
yes, sir.
And then for TBLs, you've got trading as
right.
With different names. That doesn't fall.
That don't apply, no.
No.
The TBLs don't apply.
No, I say the trading as, you're using a different name.
Yeah, but again,
under the umbrella.
Okay. We're only interested in. Yes, sir.
Sorry, guys, you're late. I don't know if you touched on already, but I'm a director of a company. It's a local ordinary company.
Right.
That belongs to a trust.
Right.
The trustee is a professional company registered with FEMA.
Right.
And who should be listed as beneficial owner, and also how can I register that company at the CDP if I am not a shareholder? Who can register that company there?
The trustee.
The trustee will do it.
Yeah.
And they're telling me they're not doing it. So how can I, as a director, do that?
Well, the trustee is really beneficial on it. You didn't do it. And you're saying that you have an ordinary company.
Uh-huh.
And the trust is a shareholder, or the trust is
The trust company is the shareholder. It's listed
100%?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Well, then the trustee.
Yeah, but then the law exempts companies that belong to a trustee, because they are overseen by FEMA, regulated by FEMA.
Yeah.
But still, we would have to put that information on your...
You have to put it in CBP,
uh-huh,
because it's an ordinary company.
Right.
If it was the exempt company, well, then you won't be required to file.
Yeah, the exempt company would be another.
Exactly.
But who can create the login for the company and the CDP? The trustee has to do that, or me as a director, I can do that.
You're saying that the resident company is owned by the trust.
Yeah.
And the trust is regulated by CIMA.
Yes.
So you wouldn't have to register it, because they're already regulated on that side.
Yeah, but we have to give information about the exemption.
The trustee is supposed to get that from you. You're supposed to provide that directly to the trustee as to what your exemption is, and they are supposed to then file it with their
filings. Yeah, but they would have to create a login on the CDP for each company.
No, they wouldn't do that.
No, because the company, the ordinary company, is owned by an entity that's regulated by CIMA.
Yes.
So all that information CIMA has already that you would put on here.
And then the email that was sent out?
No, because, it was just said before that ordinary companies don't get reported by financial institutions. They have to be reported on the CDP.
Yes.
So the trust company, they will not look into that, because it's not an exempted company.
Right.
And the director, me as a director, I cannot do that because I cannot log in on CDP. So who will be able to provide that information? Even if just to say this company is exempted because it belongs to a senior.
But you're a director on the ordinary company.
Yes, I am.
So therefore you could do it.
Yeah, but I already tried to create a user for the company here, and it requires the shareholder to be the local.
No, it could be a director, it could be a director, officer, director of the company, or a shareholder. What has to judge is that we should have on record documentation showing that we can verify that you did business, that you did business for the company, and that you're a director. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So I'll have to create a login for that company, my capacity as director, and then you verify that and give me the login to go in.
Correct. Yeah.
Thank you.
And then the information will be?
The information will be that the company is exempted because it belongs to a CIMA register.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good.
Sorry, I think I missed something there.
Go ahead.
An ordinary company, in this case owned by a trust that's regulated in Cayman.
Good.
All ordinary companies can only be registered, can only report their beneficial ownership information through CBP?
No, there's something we use there.
They could use the corporate services provider.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And if they are doing that, then everything's fine?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
CSP looks after that.
Okay.
Yeah, this is for ordinary companies.
I know,
who doesn't use it.
Yes,
yeah.
Thank you.
Any more questions? Well, at least I survived.
Haven't left yet. That's the way to
get out of the room.
Wait
for the phone calls. For now.
Just in case anybody needs to reach me, I can reform that Java register between 10 at night and 7 in the morning. Please don't do it for me. 10 at night and 7 in the morning.
Just one more question. Has there been any format released for situations where the corporate services provider has updated the portal and there are no changes from month to month? Because I thought there was a different format that was going to come out for that.
Right.
Has that come out?
You mean on the CSP side?
On the CSP side. Sorry.
We were looking at that, but then we recognized it would have caused both infrastructure and more money. So we said, you know what? Unfortunately, we have to resort back to providing once a month.
Okay. So if nothing changes, you just provide
another
upload.
Yeah, just provide it. Because we're just getting a copy of your register. If no change, just keep bringing it. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, but I can just let, for those of you who's interested, let Mario just walk you real through real quick on the site here. So you just get a look and feel of what it looks like, but when you get on, you're not completely lost. And stick away.
Perfect. Thank you.
Stand away. I can see.
Okay. I hope everybody can see the screen well enough. So the idea is for me just to quickly show you a quick demo of this, which how the site would work. We can maybe just go through how you register, and then we'll maybe just show you a couple of sort of filings that you can do on the site, and just give you a little bit of an idea of, you know, which how it would be running. So like Mr. Donnie was saying, there's a couple of different ways of getting to the actual portal. The first thing, obviously, just as mentioned, is a website called cdt.ky. Please obviously have a look at it. From this website, there's a lot of information. From here, you can obviously sign in. You'll notice right on the top right-hand side, you can click and sign in, which will take you to the actual sign-in website. Okay? So this is the portal, like we call it, the CDT site. Maybe there's a couple of things to notice. The address on top, cdt.secure.ky. That's where you want to go to obviously register, and that's also where you log into the portal to obviously do all your different filings. Okay? So I thought what I'll quickly do is this, we can just do a dummy sign up to show you how to sign up and what will be required. And then we'll just jump into the demo environment, which is just a little site we've created with some information just to show you if you've already signed up, how, you know, which how you do your sort of filings. Okay? So really simple. You're just gonna go to the site. If you wish you haven't registered, then you just need to go ahead and sign up right at the bottom. So we'll do that. You will obviously require, the first thing you'll require, this obviously as you're signing up, is a valid email address just to verify you who you are and to get a little PIN, just from a security sort of point of view. So I'll just use my address this as a test. I'm just going to put in my Gmail, and I'm going to say, I'm not a robot, hopefully. You might sometimes at this stage, if you've done it a couple of times and never completed it, you might get a little verification, say, like with different pictures, or say like show, tick all the pictures that has a car on it as an example, so we can obviously stop automated sort of people trying to hit the site and just, you know, break the site in a sense. So we'll do that. I'm going to click on send me a PIN. It will say the PIN has been sent. So if you guys give me 1 second, I'm just going to see, hopefully I get it quickly on my phone. Okay, so I just got an email. It will come through, obviously it's really small, but it will say a Canon Business Portal verification PIN. Just make sure you put that PIN in here, on the verification PIN down here. So 1273922. And then we're going to say verify my PIN. Okay, so that will actually allow you to go into the obviously sign up sort of process. Again, we've tried to make it pretty simple just to sign up a little bit of information. I'll try and go this high sort of level through it all, just obviously for a little bit of save a little bit of time. So step one will just be your details, the person that's registering into the site. Just your own personal information, your name, given name, middle name if you have obviously family name. And you just work your way as you start typing it in, and the site will take you obviously to the next step. Step number two is where you're obviously the verification. At this point, it's just the verification of the person that's signing up. So if I'm signing up myself, being a director maybe, this is where you obviously upload your information. So like Mr. Donnie and Mr. Paul were saying, different type of verification, passport, driver license, ESID if you do have one, or obviously a voter registration card. Really simple, obviously scan it in, and then from here, just select the file PDF document you have. If it is a passport or a driver's license, this upload the file and then obviously just put in your ID number into it. What country, issue date, expiry date.
Sorry, question. Does the scan have to be in color, or can it be in black and white?
Preferred color.
Color.
Okay. You will also notice that some of the things we've left a little information, tab next to it. So if you're not sure what's up, as an example, what type of files you would need, just keep your mouse over it and we'll give you a little bit more information on that as well. Okay? So that's second step, verification of identification. Third step will be your actual username that you will use to log into the site. Okay? So that's, you can choose obviously what you want to do. This has to be lowercase. Your name and surname. We don't allow special characters on the username, so don't use like your email address. This select that will tell you if it's already in use. And then in the password, normally at least like 8 characters, uppercase, lowercase, number, and a letter. But the system will warn you if it doesn't meet the requirements of the password. Obviously, make sure that you keep your password safe somewhere, because obviously that's really important later on. And obviously, you don't want anyone just to get it, because then they can obviously do filings on it. Did you have a question? Oh, sorry, I thought somebody on this side, I saw a finger, sorry. okay, so obviously select username and password, and then at the bottom over here, in step number 4, is the last step where you'll obviously select your entities. Okay, so we'll go back one second quickly here. So over here, you've got a choice. You can either add one, so if you have multiple entities, you can add one entity,